Well, good evening. It's certainly changed this morning. It was a sunny morning, and now it's sort of overcast, but it's the day the Lord has made. Welcome to our worship here and wherever you're watching from. We're going to hear some words to call us into the presence of the Lord. Why don't we stand together? Praise ye the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. And we'll begin our praise of the Lord with our first hymn for the evening, which is number 345. Glorious things of thee are spoken. 345. Most merciful and lovely Father, you who are infinite, eternal, and unchangeable in your being, wisdom, power, holiness, justice, goodness, and truth, you, Lord, order all things, and you are the Lord of all things. And Lord, we are so privileged to come with hearts awakened to worship you. And we thank you for this Lord's Day evening and pray your grace upon our worship. And with your people throughout the world, we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Our hymn of the month is number 15, for which we will stand and must stand, since it is Stand Up and Bless the Lord. Please be seated.
Good evening. I would invite you to turn in your Bibles to the book of Acts, chapter 11, which is our scripture reading for this evening. It's interesting to see we're hearing messages from Acts and we're reading from Acts. So this is kind of a warm-up, I guess, to a message you're going to hear a few weeks or months down the line. Okay. We'll be reading from Acts chapter 11, verses 19 to 30, as we see this portion of scripture dealing with the church in Antioch at the beginning of the growth of the church. Acts 11, 19 through the end of the chapter. Hear God's word. Now those who were scattered because of the persecution that arose over Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, speaking the word to no one except Jews. But there were some of them, men of Cyprus and Cyrene, who on coming to Antioch spoke to the Hellenists also, preaching the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number who believed turned to the Lord. The report of this came to the ears of the church in Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas to Antioch. When he came and saw the grace of God, he was glad, and he exhorted them all to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast purpose. For he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and of faith. And a great many people were added to the Lord. So Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul. And when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. For a whole year, they met with the church and taught a great many people. And in Antioch, the disciples were first called Christians. Now in these days, prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch, and one of them named Agabus stood up and foretold of the Spirit that there would be a great famine over all the world. This took place in the days of Claudius. So the disciples determined, everyone according to his ability, to send relief to the brothers living in Judea. And they did so, sending it to the elders by the hand of Barnabas and Saul. Just a wonderful example of the growth of the church and how believers took on the responsibilities of caring for one another and spreading the gospel to all the nations. Well, this is an evening for prayer requests. So I've looked carefully at the list in the bulletin, but I'm curious to know if there are any additional requests at this time. Yes. Okay. So Kyle has a very important court hearing this Thursday, which is going to help determine where she's headed. And prayerfully, she's not going to be heading anywhere, but staying right where he is. So, yes. What's her name again?
Gianna.
Okay, very good. Yes.
My son Nathan will be driving from Georgia to New Mexico, Western New Mexico. He's leaving Tuesday.
Okay. I see a hand up in the...
Praise for Josh's sake.
Amen.
Anyone else? Yes.
Can I just add to the Rich and Hannah prayer for their wedding this Friday for traveling mercies for her family?
For her family, because they're all coming from
and
Pensy. Okay. So some people are traveling west from Oklahoma, and some people are traveling east from Oklahoma. Is that kind of the size of it? Okay. Never knew that Oklahoma was a starting point, but there you go. Yes, yes. Okay. Anyone else before we go to the Lord in prayer? Okay. So it is our privilege as a congregation. We should be using all that list in the bulletin as a means of when we go to the Lord in our own personal prayer lives to keep these things in mind as well. So let's go to the Lord. Lord, is our privilege to be able to come to you in prayer. Lord, we are reminded that you are the one who has made and sustained all things, and therefore it is right, Lord, that when we have concerns of our heart, there are things that cause us worry. Lord, you are the one that we can rest in. And Lord, when we receive blessings as well, we know that they are blessings that have come from your hand. So, Lord, we give you thanks for all the goodness that we have experienced, both in those very practical things of life, but Lord, for how you have cared for us. You have shown your amazing love to us, calling us out of darkness into your wonderful light. Lord, that is our desire, that we would see your kingdom increase. Lord, that we would see others come to know you as Lord and Savior. And we pray, Lord, that it might be our privilege through the way that we live out our lives, the interactions that we have with those that we work with, those in our community, perhaps even family members, Lord, that have not confessed their sins and placed their faith and trust in Christ as their only hope, Lord. That our lives would be a reflection of your grace and your mercy, and that through our witness, they might come to know you as Lord and Savior as well. Lord, we have many issues that are heavy on our hearts. Lord, we see in such stark display the evil of this world. It seems to be about us from every side, for the concerns that we have as a nation, for the sadness that we see so many calling those things that you have called sin, they are calling good, and they are finding their delight in it. Lord, it is an awful thing, because we are reminded of the judgment and punishment, Lord, that all sin deserves, including our sin, but for the grace and mercy that you have shown us through what Christ has done. So we pray, Lord, for safety for those that are in dangerous places. And there are many of them. We think of those, and we've been praying for the people of Ukraine, Lord, for particularly for the believers there, and for those that are seeking to carry out missions of mercy to those people as this conflict has drug on for many, many months. And the carnage and the death toll only seems to rise. We pray, Lord, for that there might be peace, there might be a resolution, Lord, that those that have done wrong would find be justly judged. As well, Lord, these incidences in Israel are a shock to us. The callous disregard for life, almost the joy in taking life that has been expressed by those that have engaged in this attack. Lord, it is so difficult for us to comprehend how the hearts and minds of men can conjure up such evil. But for the fact that it's happened before, and we can assure that as long as Satan roams this earth and works in the hearts of men, Lord, that it may happen again. So we pray, Lord, for the protection of the people in Israel. Lord, we pray in particular for believers that are there, Lord, that you would guide and protect them. But Lord, even through this, may those that are in this distress and stressful situation, Lord, find their only hope in you as their only hope in this life and in the life to come. We thank you, Lord, for how providentially you cared for Josh, that he was able to get a relatively early flight out and has been able to make it safely home. Lord, we know this is a major disruption in his educational plans, and we ask, Lord, that you would be gracious in helping him sort out what the next steps are. We pray, Lord, that you would be with those that still may remain there that are desirous of leaving. We pray, Lord, for safety for those that are engaged in this conflict. And we leave these things in your hands. Lord, as well, we pray for those of our number who challenged with different health needs. So, Lord, we want to remember to you Tracy Morris. Lord, she's had some good news, but she still has many physical struggles that she has to deal with. Ask, Lord, that you would be with Bob Mixner with his treatments, Lord, bringing him through round one, and, Lord, that these treatments would effectively take care of the cancer. As well, Lord, we pray for Janice Barron's brother, John, with different health issues that he has, and for Jim Roush's grandson, Patrick, as he's recovering from his accident. Lord, we as well want to remember Bill Slack, suffering from cancer, significantly weakened. We know his wife as well is suffering from some difficulties. Lord, he is a dear brother in Christ, and we have stood beside him in different ministries. So we ask, Lord, that you would care for him. Be with he and his family as they make decisions regarding their care. Be with their church as well. He has had such a significant influence in ministry in that city for so many years. And him not being in the pulpit has to have a significant effect on them. We pray as well that you'd be with Bob Graham, that you would relieve him from the pain, Lord, that you would give him strength. We thank you for his willingness to continue to kind of soldier on, to use his gifts to our benefit in church as he plays the piano for us. We ask, Lord, that you would be with Bruce Fenton, with this upcoming doctor's appointment that he has this week in regards to making decisions about treatment options. Lord, help him to make a good decision about that. And Lord, we pray for those expectant mothers, for Miranda, for Evie McArdle, for Allison Groot, and now we add Gianna to this list of church members or family members. It is a wonderful blessing to see, to anticipate young lives coming into this world, particularly within the household of faith. And we pray, Lord, your care of those that carry these children. And we pray, Lord, that there might be uneventful births and healthy children as a result. We pray as well, Lord, that this week that Rich Dugan and his fiancée Hannah will be joined, will be marrying this Friday, and we know her family, much of it's coming from Oklahoma. Lord, that there might be safety in making the trip here for each one of them. Lord, that this might be a joyous occasion around the joining of these two together. We thank you, Lord, for their expressions of faith and their desire to serve you in their lives. And we pray, Lord, for those that serve on mission fields. We pray for the Hop family, for the nation that they seek to serve. Haiti is a nation of such unrest, and it's a dangerous place to be. So while the Hops seek to minister to believers there from afar, we pray, Lord, that there would be a time when they would be able to return and be on that island nation and carry out the ministry they so desire to be involved in. We know, Lord, that is one of a number of places where to name the name of Christ is very dangerous. So we pray, Lord, for those many places in the world where there is great open hostility and sometimes violence that's brought to bear against those that try to live out a life of faith in a sin-sick world. Lord, this has been the history of the church. In some ways, it's in some manner it has been the cause of the church growing. So our prayer is that even though these dear saints struggle, have to deal with much, Lord, the result is that their testimony would be so clear that it would draw others to you. Their only hope. We thank you, Lord, for our church family, for the opportunity to be together. Lord, help us always to remember to care for each other. We pray for our shut-ins, those who are unable to be with us. And we pray as well for those that we haven't seen, that there isn't any reason that we're aware of that they have not been with us, Lord, that we might have that heart of concern to reach out and to challenge them and encourage them as well. But this evening, Lord, we give you thanks that we have the privileges of hearing your word opened and preached and taught to us. May it strengthen us in our faith and our resolve to serve you. And Lord, we pray all of these things with confidence in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Before the message, I would invite you to turn to hymn 478. I love to tell the story as our hymn of preparation before the message. And please stand as we sing 478.
Glory. seated. Well, there's a story about, circulating in the Wycliffe Bible translator circles about a woman named Sadie who for years served as a house mother for children in missionary children in the Philippines. And Sadie loved books. And she was very generous, loaning out many of her books, but she kept a certain special number of books to herself. She had them locked up in a locker under her bed. She was very possessive of them. She guarded them very carefully. They were very special to her. But one night, as the story goes, she heard this sort of funny noise. And, And she wondered what it could be. And she started looking all around. And finally, she opened up the footlocker and discovered there was nothing left but an enormous pile of dust. All those books had been chewed up by termites. She lost them. So the parable, or the moral of the story, is what we give away, we keep, but what we hoard, we lose. One of the great blessings and the blessed responsibility of the church and mature fruit-bearing Christians is to give away the message of faith in the gospel. And that's always the way it's been. In the Old Testament, the Jews were not very good about giving away their faith. But everything began to change very dramatically in the New Testament age, when all of a sudden things began to explode. And we are seeing that in the book of Acts. We're now in Acts chapter 5. So if you'll turn to Acts 5, verse 17, we'll read through verse 42. Acts 5, 17 to 42. But the high priest rose up, and all who were with him, that is, the party of the Sadducees, and filled with jealousy, they arrested the apostles and put them in public prison. But during the night, an angel of the Lord opened the prison doors and brought them out and said, "Go and stand in the temple and speak to the people all the words of this life." And when they heard it, they entered into they heard it into the temple, and at daybreak, and began to teach. Now, when the high priest came and those who were with him, they called together the council, all the senate of the people of Israel, and sent to the prison to have them brought. But when the officers came, they did not find them in the prison. So they returned and reported, "We found the prison securely locked, and the guards standing at the doors, but when we opened them, we found no one inside." Now, when the captain of the temple and the chief priests heard these words, they were greatly perplexed about them, wondering what would this would come to. And someone came and told them, "Look, the men whom you put in prison are standing in the temple and teaching the people." When the captain with the officers went and brought them, not by force, for they were afraid of being stoned by the people. And when they had brought them, they set them before the council, and the high priest questioned them, saying, "We strictly charged you not to teach in this name. Yet here you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching, and you intend to bring this man's blood upon us." But Peter and the apostles answered, "We must obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised Jesus, whom you killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him at his right hand as leader and savior to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses to these things. And so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him. When they heard this, they were enraged and wanted to kill them. But a Pharisee in the council named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law, held in honor by all the people, stood up and gave orders to put the men outside for a little while. And he said to them, "Men of Israel, take care what you are about to do with these men. For before the days of Thutis rose up, claiming to be somebody, and a number of men, about 400, joined him. He was killed, and all his followers, all who followed him, were dispersed and came to nothing. After him, Judas the Galilean rose up in the days of the census and drew away some people after him. He too perished, and all who followed him were scattered. So in the present case, I tell you, keep away from these men and let them alone. For if this plan or this undertaking is of man, it will fail. But if it is of God, you will not be able to overthrow him. You might even be found opposing God." So they took his advice, and when they had called in the apostles, they beat them and charged them not to speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. Then they left the presence of the council, rejoicing that they had been counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name. And every day in the temple and from house to house, they did not cease teaching and preaching that the Christ is Jesus. So for the purposes of establishing the church in the New Testament age in this fertile climate, yet very hostile soil, you might say that God jump-started the church with the liberal use of many miracles and wonders administered exclusively, almost exclusively, through the ministry of the 12 apostles. And we might have read of that in verses 12 through 17, where we read about all of the great works and signs and wonders and how multitudes were being brought into the church. And the apostles were told to perform miraculous signs and wonders. Doubtless they healed many diseases, ailments. And they were getting the attention of a lot of people through all this in Jerusalem, together with the preaching of the gospel, which invariably accompanied it, as did Peter with the man who was crippled from birth. It was causing the fledgling Jerusalem congregation to grow with remarkable speed. We read in verse 14, "More and more men and women believed in the Lord and were added to their number, added to those saved at Pentecost." The congregation there in Jerusalem may well, at this point, have numbered 4,000. That's a huge number of people back then in Jerusalem, which wouldn't have been nearly the size it is today. Which, we're told in verse 17, filled, not surprisingly, the high priest and his friends, the associates, well-connected members of the Sanhedrin, filled them with fear and jealousy. These rulers were angry, they were fearful, they were jealous of the following of Jesus and the apostles, which was growing and growing very fast. They had previously met, you recall, at least a portion of the Sanhedrin had met and hauled two of the apostles, Peter and John, before themselves, and you recall, and they reference it, had commanded him them to speak no longer in the name of Jesus. The two apostles gave them no promises of that whatsoever, but impertinently replied that they would obey God rather than man. That's recorded in chapter 4. Now, a short time later, chapter 5, as the apostles continued to preach Christ, the high priest and his associates determined to put an end to the whole matter, and they round up the entire number, all of the apostles. And they knew who these men were by now. And they rounded them up and they threw them in the public jail until they could be tried. But what happens? Well, we're not given a lot of detail. It's not too important, but in a sense, it's a beautiful passage. The angel of the Lord appears at the city slammer and opens the doors and escorts them all out. And he gives them some very specific instructions. He says, go, stand in the temple courts, and tell the people the full message of this new life. Hot dog! Back to the temple courts. They loved to go to the temple courts and preach there. They were crowded. And come daylight, they hustle right over, and they start in on it, preaching and teaching any who were by and telling the people the full message of this new life. So, what is this message of new life? Well, we know it's the message of the gospel. It's the same message that we're called to share today. What do we know about it? Well, probably the best thing to say is to think about the old life. What do we know about the old life, the old unconverted life? That's the life of a man or a woman whose soul has been deadened by the result of sin. The Apostle Paul put it this way. He said, the God of this world has blinded the minds of unbelievers so they cannot see the light of the glory of the gospel of Christ, who is the image of God. Consequently, the old life is dry, often filled with spiritual dryness. It may seem empty, futile. It may be characterized by continual frustrations and angers in life in general, God in specific. The old life is the life of the natural unconverted man, ruled by pride, cynicism, unbelief. A man living the old life is ultimately a pawn of the devil. The old life is what we get until we have the new life. The old life may be very religious, filled with ritual and activity, as I mentioned some of it this morning, but ultimately it's characterized by a pretty low view of God and his holiness and a pretty high view of man and his abilities. But I think most of you know what the Bible says about the old life. It says on no uncertain terms that the unconverted man or woman who is spiritually dead will end in death and judgment. The book of Revelation speaks of those who were saved and delivered from the old life and whose names are written in the Lamb's book of life. But the unconverted whose life, whose name does not appear in that book will share the fate of the devil and his angels, which is too horrible to speak of in a nice fall evening. But God wants the world to know the good news of the gospel. He wants this to be known. Tell the people, he says, tell the people. This is the angel. Tell the people about this full message of new life. The message of the new life is that we're, who are spiritually dead, can be made alive. Our lawful attitude, our unlawful attitude, our attitude toward God by a supernatural work of God's grace can change us. Therefore, if any man is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. The Apostle Paul, remember, speaks to the Philippian jailer who calls to him, what must I do to be saved? And Paul doesn't give him a list of things to do, a checklist. He says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you'll be saved. And I like, by the way, to see it translated the way I just quoted it to you, with the word on or upon instead of the word in. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Because there's many people who very readily say they believe in Jesus. They'll acknowledge his historical existence. But in order to be saved, to get this new life, we do have to do more than simply believe in the existence of Christ. Even the devil believes in Jesus in that sense. But no, to be saved, rather we need to cast ourselves upon the Lord. And somebody might throw himself off the end of a dock, throw himself onto this boat that's the last ship leaving the desert island that's filled with death and destruction and deadly disease. Or it's somebody might leap out of the window of a burning building into a net held below by firemen. It's that sort of thing. To believe on Jesus is to completely abandon ourselves to him as if he's our only hope. And furthermore, when we believe in Jesus, we're expressing unqualified agreement with everything he tells us about our guilt and sin, and at the same time accept everything he says about himself as our Savior and our payment for all of our sin. Well, this is what the apostles standing in the temple courts were telling people, the very message that I'm seeking to express. This is the way to the new life, and the only life. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. And this is the message we're responsible for as disciples of Christ, to believe it and to share it. So the message itself, the full message of new life. We need to understand the gospel and how important it is. But now a second thing, and that is where this message is taken or where it's to be heard. The angel brings them out of prison, and he doesn't do what we were supposed he might have done at all. We suppose he might have told them to, you know, folks, man, I want you to just go home, get your family, get your pets together, and it's time to leave. You know, just we need to give the Sanhedrin a little room. You know, they're pretty smoked right now. You know, the Lord appreciates your good effort, but things are a little intense. It may be time to put the gospel under wraps for a little bit. He doesn't say that at all, does he? Quite the opposite. He sends them right back into the maw of all of the troubles, right back to the temple courts, continually filled with people, the heartbeat of the Jewish religion, very public place. Because that, brothers and sisters, is where the good news belongs. Some people will sort of suggest to you that religion is sort of a private thing and should be, you know, a private thing and not something they're particularly interested in even hearing you talk about. And it should be something that takes place in the confines, the dignified confines of the church, where the lights are properly dimmed. And where nothing is, you know, made too loud. But they didn't get that idea from the Bible or God. You and I know that sharing the gospel, that it belongs in the public square, at chapel in the middle of the boardwalk in Wildwood, for example, is just the right place. Years ago, some of us used to... I don't know if there's anybody in this congregation, but used to be, we would go into Cowtown to the flea market, and Tim Cummings would hire a table, and we would stand on the table and just preach Christ. And my favorite place, by the way, was by the bathrooms. There was only one set of bathrooms in all that place, and people would have to come and wait, you know, for their wife or husband or children. And so we were carrying on right there. I mean, we had a captive audience. Great place to do that. Westminster professor and Dr. Jack Miller was known to preach on the corner of 5th and Olney in Philadelphia. And the celebrated Reformed apologist, Dr. Cornelius Van Til, no less, preached in Wall Street in New York City to stockbrokers when they came out. Their people really needed to hear the gospel. I think Bill Welzine still preaches at Mallory Square, and many of our churches set up tables and pass out literature at local fairs and farm markets. That's good. The gospel belongs on social media. We need to muscle our way into all of that. And our worship services should be streamed real time, or at least uploaded on church websites and so forth. That's good too. The apostles were delighted to take this message into the crowded precincts of the temple, and were not to be intimidated, because they had got their orders from the Lord, the creator and ruler and redeemer of the universe, their Savior Jesus. So this good news is not a private message. It's not a health remedy. It's not a scheme for moral improvement. It's the word of life to be carried throughout the world, and even to places that may not wish to hear it. I have two good friends who are both really brilliant electronic design engineers, who both have had very long, successful careers in industry, but who are giving their retirement years working as volunteers for Trans World Radio, enabling the broadcast of the gospel in places where missionaries are scarce. That's what they're doing. Because this message, this full message of new life, needs to be taken everywhere. It's that important. It's that good. But before we move on, let me mention one other place where the gospel is needed, and that's in our own homes. Our text tells us that when the 12 finally got loose from the Sanhedrin, having been beaten but not killed, they went right on doing what they were told not to do. Verses 41 and 42 of the text. And then they left the presence of the council, rejoicing they'd been counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name. And every day in the temple and from house to house, they did not cease teaching and preaching that the Christ is Jesus. So they taught in the temple courts, and they taught from house to house, not only publicly, but privately on every occasion. They never stopped teaching and proclaiming. Now, most of us are going to have more opportunities to share the gospel in our own homes, in the homes of friends and family, than we will public opportunities. In our homes and in the homes of others in private places, we often have a hearing. There's people who will listen to us, people who love us, who will bear to listen to us. Even if they're sort of rolling their eyes, they will give you a hearing. And sometimes God blesses that. With Thanksgiving and Christmas holiday seasons approaching, we all have family. We'll be in our homes. We'll go to other homes or visit friends in their homes. Why not begin praying even now in November or October that God will give you words and give you an opportunity? Lord, I need it on a silver platter. You know, it's got to be really in front of my face, you know, but you can do this, you know. And so we can emulate the examples of the apostles. Well, now, one last thing, and not to be overlooked in this text. We've looked at the message itself and where the message is taken, but I think we also want to see how God blesses this message, his gospel. We've already seen in Acts 4, that how God blesses the words and witness of Peter and John, explaining the healing of the beggar in Acts 4. In this text, we see how God the Holy Spirit had very evidently given these two men, who were simple fishermen, amazing grace and freedom to speak clearly and boldly to the very body of men who had only recently ordered the crucifixion of their beloved friend, the Lord Jesus, and to speak to them in a most convicting and compelling manner. It must have shocked themselves. Maybe you've had the experience where you do have some opportunity to talk to somebody, and afterwards you think, wow, I don't know how I pulled that off. You know, that was pretty good. You know, I actually said something. You know, I actually remembered some scripture. Well, the Lord does that. In chapter 5 now, notice how he gives the entire group of apostles another opportunity to speak to these same religious leaders one more time. Gathered before these religious leaders, these Sadducees, are the 12 apostles. I mean, what an opportunity. Not only, if it was not enough what they heard from Peter and John, now the 12 are in front of them. God has given them the, nobody ever got a chance like these guys got, right? They're all there, and what a remarkable witness. Was Gamaliel the only one honest enough to at least wonder whether this gospel might be from God? Well, we're not told. These men were pretty angry and pretty blind, but God, in his mercy, gave them yet another opportunity because he loves to do that. God delights to take his gospel everywhere to many unexpected persons and to many expected places. God always blesses his word. Who knows how God may have added supernatural grace, and who knows how God will add supernatural grace to your stammering testimony? Who knows how the Holy Spirit might enable even the most garbled gospel presentation to bring amazing grace and life to some hard-headed, high-handed, intimidating, blessed sinner in your life. God loves to do it. It's not the crafty, persuasive words that God uses. I mean, even the Apostle Paul, who was by no means a small intellect, confesses to the church in Corinth, "I came to you in weakness and fear and with much trembling. My message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power, so that your faith might not rest on men's wisdom, but on God's power." So can you get some hope from this text? This is not a text that I'm sort of suggesting as sort of another rap on the knuckles, like, you know, get out there and do it. It's a message of hope. We get some hope in this. We think, man, what God can do. These apostles were just simple, you know, in many ways, probably mediocre men. But because God is committed to his gospel and his people as a means of salvation, he'll do it. I mean, God doesn't have to save people this way. I mean, he could have just sent down bolts of lightning, you know, to his elect. You know, and we would all just sort of relax at home. But for some reason, he didn't do that, did he? He chose us. And we sit around and we look at one another and we look at ourselves and we think, oh, that was a good choice. But that's what God purposes, and he will and can use us when we take his words in our mouths. Every willing messenger. I'm speaking about how God blesses the message, uses the willing messenger. It shouldn't escape our notice that if the Sanhedrin had had their way, of course, and followed their initial impulse, they would have executed, probably stoned to death, all 12 of the apostles that stood before them. And what would that have left the church with? What would have happened to the gospel? How would God have gone forward without these men? But the Lord knows what he's doing, doesn't he? He chose each of us. And it doesn't happen because God doesn't let it happen. He raises up this man, Gamaliel, probably the only man amongst them who had the stature and the personal authority to sway the Sanhedrin from their murderous intentions instead of sending them away scot-free or almost. From a human standpoint, Gamaliel's advice was really not very good. Now, if his purpose was to stop the gospel, it was nothing better than to do in these 12 apostles. But he was wise enough to know that possibly this was from God, and likely it would never come of anything, but possibly it was from God. And if it was, he didn't want to be one who was fighting God. And it might not be a good idea to destroy those 12 apostles. It might not go down well with them to be accounted as the guys who killed the 12 apostles. God protects his message and his messengers for the sake of his purpose. He raises up this prominent Pharisee, one of their own teachers, Gamaliel. Now, later, what God would bring about a great persecution, and we sort of got some hint of that from the reading earlier this evening. But that would cause hundreds, perhaps thousands of disciples to flee from Jerusalem and consequently would scatter all over the world, taking the gospel with them. God knows what he's doing. And he's doing a blessed thing with his gospel, the full message of life. And he's doing it still today, causing his people to carry his word. God delights to bless his word and to press the blessing of real life in the darkest places, in the most resistant hearts. Islam is a very dark religion, and there is light going forth around the world, and we're thankful for that. We know what darkness is, and we pray for these people. They're not monsters. They need Christ, and they need what God has graciously done for us. Well, here's the conclusion. Like Sadie's books, again, what we give away, we keep. And what we hoard, we lose. We can't, what we keep under lock and key, we lose. We actually do lose the gospel when we don't give it away. We actually do lose it in a sense. We lose, by losing our love for it, by losing any sense of urgency for it, we lose our confidence in the power of it. But it doesn't become less powerful. The message itself, this new life of Christ, is priceless. And the places where it needs to be heard are without number. And the manner in which he blesses it is most encouraging. Indeed, one of the greatest and most blessed responsibilities of the church and mature fruit-bearing Christians is participating in the great giveaway. The great giveaway, the full message of the new life of saving gospel of Christ. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for showing us in this text how you are not to be stopped, and your purposes will bring about good things. Lord, we're thankful too when we think of this opportunity that you gave to these hard-headed men to hear the gospel not once but twice, and not from just anyone but from apostles filled with your Spirit. Lord, we're thankful. We look at some we know perhaps, and we think, well, maybe they could hear it too. Lord, we ask that you would give us opportunities to share this wonderful message, to participate in the great giveaway. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. Well, that brings us to our final hymn, which actually is in this book. So if you'll turn to page 99, we'll sing Wonderful, Merciful Savior. This has been around for a while. Not as long as some of the ones in the hymnal, but it's pretty good. Let's stand and sing.
Now may the Lord of peace give you peace at all times and in every way. The Lord be with you all.
And